I'm Dr. Sandra Grady Yates, professor in the School of Business and Public Administration at the University of the District of Columbia and president of the Paul Phillips Cooke Scholarship Fund, Incorporated. On this edition of In His Own Words, we share with you some of the thoughts of distinguished scholar, author, statesman, and former president of the District of Columbia Teachers College, Dr. Paul Phillips Cooke, from an interview conducted with him just before the turn of the century. Dr. Cooke was born to Lewis Phillip and Mamie P. Cooke on June 29, 1917 in New York City. He attended DC Public Schools and matriculated at the renowned Paul Lawrence Dunbar High School, receiving his diploma in 1933. He earned a Bachelor of Science degree, cum laude, in English from Minor Teachers College in 1937, and went on to receive a Master of Arts degree in Education from New York University in 1941, a Master of Arts degree in English Literature from the Catholic University of America in 1943, and a Doctorate in Education from Columbia University in 1947. He was married to his Minor Teachers College sweetheart, Rose Clifford, for 63 years, and together they had two daughters and a son. Dr. Cooke was a professor of English at DC Teachers College for 30 years and served as president of the college from 1966 to 1974. He authored more than 200 publications and papers, won the admiration and respect of his associates in numerous arenas, and was active in many professional, social, international, community, and civic organizations. Dr. Cooke's light shone brightly for decades as he led by example and always demanded excellence and more from himself, students, and colleagues. The entire University of the District of Columbia family and the Washington, D.C. community were terribly heartbroken at the death of Dr. Paul Phillips Cooke on July 4, 2010 in Washington, D.C. We share this tribute of Dr. Cooke to celebrate the depth of his knowledge about the history of public education in the District of Columbia and his love for the people of this great city. And now, Dr. Paul Phillips Cooke, in his own words.
On July 1st, 1974, I was testifying before the House Congressional Committee, the appropriate House Congressional Committee, in support of a university for the District of Columbia then, and that law eventuated into the doors opening to students 3 years later, September 1st, 1977. The university came about as it was a consolidation, that was the verb that was used, the term that was used, of three public colleges that were in existence already. One was the District of Columbia Teachers College, which had come into existence on July 1st, 1955. And then the two subsequent colleges, one was Federal City College, the other Washington Technical Institute, both of which were established by the Congress of the United States in 1966. So there were three public colleges that were consolidated to form the University of the District of Columbia. Now, where did the District of Columbia Teachers College come from? And I'll probably refer to it as DCTC for brevity. It was a merger, and that was the word used that time, consolidation other time, this time it's merger, of Wilson Teachers College and Minor Teachers College. Now, what preceded both of those in this history of the University of the District of Columbia? Well, we have an interesting establishment of the first public normal school in this city in 1873 by the territory of the District of Columbia. That's part of the history of the government of this city now, because then it was a territory, the district, rather than what we know of it today with a council and all. Then it was had a territory and it had a legislature. And that legislature established in 1873 Washington Normal School, which was thus the predecessor of all the public institutions prior to the University of the District of Columbia, or UDC. Well, how does Matilda Minor get into it? Let me say this one thing I think is always interesting, because there's an image I think of Matilda Minor, prim little lady moving around. So I won't say that Matilda Minor had a boyfriend. We won't go into that part of it in the history of Matilda Minor. But the other part of it is that what she created in 1851 was a private school, the first public normal school that enrolled black students, was opened in 1879 when the private Matilda Minor normal schools were taken over, and not any kind of strong word, it was an agreement between the two boards, the board of the public schools and the board of the Matilda Minor private school. They reached an agreement, and in 1879, the first public normal school for colored students was established. That is a predecessor too, you see, of UDC and Minor Teachers College and Minor Normal and all. But as a private school, it's sometimes not exactly linked to the history of the University of the District of Columbia. Her private school was first started, by the way, at 11th and New York Avenue. There's a historic preservation of the Greyhound bus terminal on one corner of that same intersection. She had several other sites on F Street, around 14th and F Street, finally getting a very good site at what was then known as 20th Street, West End Street North. That's interesting, because we would say 20th and N Streets, you see, but that's the way they put it then. And that's where her school, that had real, shall we say, business or financial value, because when it was finally sold, it brought in a whole lot of money. And that was the beginning of what was known as the Matilda Minor Fund. Matilda Minor Fund, by the way, in this history prior to the University of the District of Columbia, Matilda Minor Fund was used to help Howe University, Lincoln University, Manassas Industrial School, Minor Teachers College. That money lasted a long time, right on up to the 1930s. That money was still around from the sale of that very valuable property, 20th and N Street, which, by the way, if you picture geographically in the city, is just a block off of DuPont Circle. And you can generally conclude or realize how much that property was valuable off of DuPont Circle. I came into Minor Teachers College in 1933, graduating in 1937. Incidentally, my wife of 62 years, by the way, of marriage, she came to Minor in 1937. I attended Minor Teachers College before later earning degrees at New York University, Catholic University, and the doctorate at Columbia University, with some postgraduate doctoral study at American University. My college, and the one I always remember, is Minor Teachers College. Well, I thought I had a very good major in English with a minor in history that prepared me for my master's degree at both at Catholic University, which was in the field of English language and literature, and my teacher education degree at New York University. That was 1941. So I thought Minor gave me a very good education, as I thought it gave to hundreds of us who went to Minor, which existed now from 1929, when the Congress of the United States established the first public teachers' college, not a normal school now, on up to 1955, when again the Congress acted to merge both Wilson Teachers College and Minor Teachers College. Well, the students there came from the primarily from the public high schools, named alphabetically. It was Armstrong High School, Cardoza High School, and Dunbar High School. But what I found, I was a good number of students were coming from North Carolina. I found that out later. I didn't always know that. I mean, from Pennsylvania, from New Jersey down, because, well, Washington, D.C. always had a good reputation. Let me add one thing going all the way back to 1905. I go back to 1905 because Booker T. Washington was here in this city then, and he gave the commencement address for three public institutions: Armstrong High School, M Street High School, and Minor Normal School. And he said that day, now you people here in the District of Columbia are very fortunate. You have more money spent for your education, public education, in this city than we, now this is Booker T. Washington himself speaking, than we in Alabama have for the education of Negroes in the whole state of Alabama. So you see, we had pretty good money here in the District of Columbia, and this, I'm talking about a predecessor of the Minor Teachers College that I went to, opened its doors in 1929, I'm there in 1933, and we're attracting students from the South, from the Middle Atlantic, and all the way up to New Jersey, and from New York, too. Incidentally, I'd been teaching at Brown Junior High School after finishing Minor. See, I taught at Brown Junior High School in 1941-42. I taught at Phelps Vocational School from 1942 to 44. And then in November of 44, I was appointed to Minor Teachers College to the faculty in English. I remained there till a gentleman named Franklin Delano Roosevelt asked me to join his army. In other words, I was drafted. So I served in the Army Air Corps, 3rd Army Air Corps, by way of the Army Air Force. There was no separate Air Force then. And when I was discharged, I came back to the District of to Minor Teachers College, and was on the faculty then until it was merged, and I use that verb again, word again, merged with Wilson Teachers College to form Minor Teachers College in 1955. By that time, by the way, I had become a professor of English, and in 1955, I'm then become a faculty member, a professor at the district, DCTC. Now, you asked me about being president. Well, first I was a professor, then an academic dean, acting academic dean, where a very famous and very able dean named Matthew Jackson Whitehead was in, I think it was in Nigeria, in Lagos, Nigeria, helping to set up their first teachers' college there, their federal teachers' college in Nigeria. So over the 2 years while he was in Nigeria, I was acting academic dean, and then I became president of the District of Columbia Teachers College in September of 1966, remained president to my retirement in 1974. Well, what I liked about the Teachers College students is they talk. That is, they went into the schools and became teachers in the elementary schools, in the junior high schools, in the senior high schools. That, to me, has always been the most gratifying reflection of it, that you prepare to teach and then you go in to teach. On the other hand, since at the time that I was there and all the way up until the time of Federal City College and Washington Technical Institute, there was no other public higher education. Many of those students went on, and today the United States District Court Chief Judge, normally Holloway Johnson, is a graduate of the District of Columbia Teachers College, and a minor teachers college. She went there in part, having taught school for a while before she went to law school. And now I simply repeat, she's the presiding judge of the United States District Federal Court. So there were any number of students who didn't choose to teach or who taught for a while and then went into other areas of life besides teaching. So that was, I thought, gratifying that they got that kind of an education at either Minor Teachers College or the District of Columbia Teachers College, so that they could go into other fields beside teaching. Although, as always, I repeat, I want you to teach. The Supreme Court of the United States in 1973 in the Thompson Restaurant case said to Thompson Restaurant, you cannot exclude people on account of race. And that is 1973, and this said it was the end of all segregation and separation and exclusion in restaurants. And this said, now what does the Supreme Court base its opinion on? Well, it based its opinion on the legislation of the territory of the District of Columbia. And not too many people knew that at one time between 1871 and 1874, the District of Columbia was the territory of the District of Columbia. And during that time, legislation was passed in June of 1872 and 73 that said every restaurant shall serve, quote, every well-behaved, comma, respectable person, end quote, required by law. That's what the Supreme Court was at 80 years later. Said, that's the law. You got to open these restaurants up. And incidentally, what is called the domino effect is after the restaurants were opened, then the hotels in Washington in the 1970s, now we're talking about, open up the hotels. And after the hotels were opened up, my veterans group, the American veterans group, we went to see President Eisenhower. I pointed out to Mr. Eisenhower, Mr. President, here all of these restaurants and hotels open up. Why don't you put your weight on the theaters, Mr. President? Mr. President, I remember he folded his arms in front of me and said, well, I don't know what President Eisenhower did, but within a year, all those theaters are also open up to everybody in the city, too. That's the reflection of this cliche, the domino effect. Well, we're going back now to 1873, and the legislation of the restaurants. Now, at the same time, the same legislature, the same session, established the first public normal school. That's June of 1873. The school opened in September 1873. It opened, by the way, in the Benjamin Franklin building. That's still standing right down here at Franklin Square. That's at 13th and K Streets. It's the historical preservation building now, National Historical Preservation. But it opened there, and only 20 white girls came. Not one colored girl came. I don't know the answer, and I shall not try in this period of time to surmise why no colored girl applied. I'm not even going to try to figure out why the legislature did not include the same language in the normal school legislation that it included in the restaurant legislation, that is, enroll every girl, every applicant who meets the criteria or something like that. But I want to make one observation. I was talking about money from Matilla Miners Fund. Some of that money I mentioned going to Howe University. Well, the money that went to Howe University was helped to establish at Howard its teacher education program also. And you might guess that some of those girls who might have gone to try to get in Washington Normal School, which enroll only white girls, said, no, I think I'll go to Howe University and get my teacher education. That may have been, here again, we are guessing, surmising, reaching some sort of judgments, but some student may get into it later this decade and dig right into it and see if we can find the history of it, what they were saying, as to whether black people and white people supported integrated or non-segregated education. When I was first asked by the Association for the Study of Afro-American Life and History to do a paper on a black college as part of their overall black history in February on the black historically black colleges and the predominantly black colleges, UDC being a predominantly black college, I wrote this paper which says, as a title, Whence Cometh University of the District of Columbia. So I always hold it up so that people who see me speaking think that at least I know partly what I'm talking about by having this paper in my hand when I really cannot read it because of low vision. But that's what this paper is. And it's a basic story of what I'm saying put into writing and having been published. Well, I think it's very important to the city, to the community. I think it's important to the nation, because I think it ought to attract people from outside of the United States. And if I would had part of a role, I would push on getting people from all over the world to come to the, but this is a great international capital. And with all the turbulence that takes place in many parts of the world, the stability pack in southeastern Balkans, and then what's taking place in the Israel and Palestine, what's taking place as we're still bringing bodies back from Vietnam. I think we could attract students from all over the world here, as well as going after University of the District of Columbia, might go after some of these ambassadors and some of these ministries here and make sure they know about what the University of the District of Columbia has to offer in a way of international affairs, as well as, without my downplaying, the community, because I certainly think that UDC must always serve in part to prepare people for the District of Columbia government. What is it that it can do in its courses for the government, and also for preparing people to work and to encourage people in the community? The community, by the way, in which I've lived in now for 73 years, same house, same community. Community service, district government service, national service, but I see a role, as I say, for international service. Look at how you can help and train people for the District of Columbia government. Whether it's not a bachelor's degree, it may be an associate degree, or it may be you just certify them for being able to do something of value to the government. Maybe only 9 semester hours as a certification of being able to do something. We did that at the District of Columbia Teachers College. We say on top of your bachelor's degree, we'll certify you as expert in handling standardized tests. You may need only 3 courses to do that on top of your degree, but you get a certificate saying you are certified to do it. So they might keep that in mind. I think it has done well. It attracts a good number of students, and it does one thing that a public university, I think, almost has to do, and that's to take students who want to go to college, whether they are going in the daytime or in the evening, and if they have to be raised to an academic level to do college work, it has those courses that can do that. George Washington, and back to 1798 and all, would be rather pleased with the University of District of Columbia and would see it's still great movement into the future to doing what he wanted a public university to do. I suppose staying by the public university has been my, is one reason to have some degree of pride, although I had no difficulty attending Howard University, and in fact, I worked at Howard University. I had four children who liked to eat regularly, so in addition to teaching at Minor Teachers College at DCTC, I'd regularly teach during the summer at Howard University. In fact, my mother finished Howard University in 1905, had a brother to finish medicine in 1907, another brother to finish Howard University in 1900, and a sister to finish Howard University in 1895. So I have nothing against the private university now. I support it. And I believe Howard University in 1964, in testifying before the Congress, I can hear Acting President Stanton Wormley saying to the, I think it was Senator Morris, Mr. President, the purpose of Howard University as a private institution is not to serve the public in the way that a public institution would do, because we are not only a private, but we are national and we are international. So once again, I see the University of the District of Columbia, and I'm proud of it, because it has served the District of Columbia well, and in my life, I can see that it continues to do an effective job, and will do effective job. There's a role in this world, in this life, in this city, for both the private and the public, and my life has been in part related to both the private, because I have degrees from Catholic University and New York University and Columbia University, for that matter, all of which are private, as well as a public institution, the District of Minor Teachers College, and the work that I did at the Minor Teachers College and the District of Columbia Teachers College, and the support for the University of the District of Columbia. What I'm saying, that what I see, though, is a role in always in this world, in this country, for the private and the public. Well, to have served the city and to have served the country as broadly as it can within the role and the limits of being a public District of Columbia University, to have served the university. I repeat that if we at the District of Columbia Teachers College could attract as many as students from 25 different nations, this is old DCTC, then Howard University, UDC, its role in the future would be to attract students from around the world to UDC, as well as from those in this area and from in this city. That's what I see in the next 10, 20, 30 years.